Full circle panel, first one for our, what will be the first in a long series, we hope. If I don't know you, I'm Andy Ogden. I think I know pretty much everybody in the room. I've got the pleasure to host a very distinguished group of alumni. I realized as we were putting this together that we span five decades with this group of people who have taken their Art Center education and turned that into various forms of success as professional careers. And of course, they have, in each case, taken on our topic tonight, which is creative risk. Speaking of creative risk, expecting everybody to show up on time so we can start is a kind of creative risk that I find that we took on tonight. But I could spend the next hour introducing everybody here. I won't. But I'm going to briefly introduce our guest panel. Julian Ryder, Advertising 72, provides his extensive experience in brand image, communications, and marketplace presence to advertisers as the marketing and advertising executive for the Ryder Communications Group. He was previously chair of Art Center's advertising department. Richard Holbrook. Transportation, 1981. He's an entrepreneur, designer, researcher, and business strategy consultant. He's the owner of Richard Holbrook Design and serves on Art Center's Board of Trustees. Kevin Bethune, Master of Science Industrial Design, 2012, brings his professional experience in nuclear engineering, corporate finance, and footwear design together in his role as Vice President of Strategic Design for BCG Digital Ventures, a subsidiary of the Boston Consulting Group. And Bruce Haven, Illustration 92, is an artist, strategist, and entrepreneur. Is chief creative officer and co-founder of Lynda.com. His creative vision was integral to its success as a leader in online training. Bruce also serves as a trustee on the Art Center College Board. Tonight we're taking on the topic of creative risk. The term has obviously been discussed many times, many different ways. To sort of kick off our discussion, we're going to take a few points that a writer, Stephen Kotler, proposed a few years ago in an article on Forbes.com regarding risk-taking and innovation. So I'll run through some of those here on our screen. Always good to define things a little bit these days, especially a term like creativity. Kotler believes that creativity is the act of making something from nothing. Says there is a deep and meaningful connection between risk-taking and creativity. When the brain encounters uncertain conditions, baser instincts and intuitive thinking take over. And I think many experts would say this goes back to some ancient kind of genetic memory. The brain's pattern recognition system starts hunting through every possible database to hunt up a solution. Hunting for dimmer connections, subtler relationships, and novel linkages. Taking risk causes the mind to stretch its muscles, creates mandatory conditions for innovation, and trains the brain to think in unusual ways. And again, some people would say that we wouldn't even be able to be here today if we didn't have that as something that was innate, that was part of our genetic memory. Because when we were headed out to come get the meal that we needed to evolve, we needed to keep this thing in mind, because it might be out there in the grass. So with that, I'm going to ask each of our different panelists to make a presentation, and we'll have some group discussion, and then after that we'll take some questions from the audience and make this into a conversation. So I'll turn it over to Julian.
If I just hit the space bar.
I don't want to spread arrows.
This arrow down will be better.
Okay.
And when you get to the first slide, you go black. Second, get it started.
Okay. I saw somebody drinking beer out there, so I'm glad somebody's going to be a little bit, maybe. I'll say some interesting things. So what I'm going to be presenting is something akin to having a dim sum meal, where you get a taste of a variety of dishes And then it's my intention that something, you know, kind of sticks or is relative. The presentation is called Creative Risk Concept or Experience. We're going to start with a short video and by taking a leap of faith. So it's about a 1.5 minute video. Sound?
There was none.
Really? You all know the music that goes with this? Okay, so we're going to come back to Indiana a little bit later. If you look up creative risk on Google, you'll find about 407,000 listings. And that includes articles and blogs and scholarly papers and scientific papers and charts and graphs and illustrations, and theories, and points of view, and much more. The one thing you won't find is any creative risk. That's because there's no such thing. Creative risk is a concept. It represents something. But the thing that it represents is not the thing. So when we talk about creative risk, we're doing just that. We're talking about it. So it's a lot like describing a great meal you ate to someone who wasn't there. They understand in detail all the ingredients, and the flavors, and the smells, and the tastes, and how much you enjoyed it. They might even be hungry after you've told them. However, the one thing they are not going to be left with is the experience of eating the meal. They're left with the concept, and that's different than the experience of eating the meal. And anyone who thinks the concept and the experience is the same thing, that's called eating the menu. So understanding creative risk and knowing about it and being an expert on it doesn't get you any closer to the experience of creative risk. Where the experience of creative risk shows up is in action. Action that occurs in the present, meaning right now, and right now, and right now, and right now. It happens when you're not there. In other words, there's just being in action. So I've experienced this throughout my career, and I'll bet you have too. It happens when I'm working with a partner on creating concepts for a project. We get so engaged with what we're doing that when we finished and we have all this pile of ideas, we can't say who or where the ideas came from. How many of you have ever had that experience? Cool. So neuroscientists, there's a neuroscience of creativity, you guys, which is very interesting. Neuroscientists have identified three types of creativity: combinational, exploratory, and transformational. Now they only deal with the combinational, and the reason they only deal with the combinational is because they're scientists and they have to measure stuff. And combinational is the only way they can measure through brain scans. What they've discovered is that during the creative process, different parts of the brain generate unfamiliar combinations of familiar ideas. So your left side of your brain is creating stuff, and the right side of your brain is creating stuff. And then it's coming together, so there's this neurons that are firing, and they come together, and what you're left with is a new idea. You've created something new. So, by the way, drugs can increase the rate at which you create ideas. And this is from the neuroscientists, by the way. So, musicians, artists, you know, it's like, you wonder how they get it done. So, referring back to what I said about not knowing where an idea comes from, I want to make sure I have the right slide. So referring back to what I said about not knowing where an idea comes from, I think it would be interesting to simultaneously test the brains of two creative people while they were in the creative process to see if the combining of the different parts of the brain expands to include the brain of the other person. Did you get that? So what I'm saying is, like, you got these ideas flying around in your own head, but there's this thing that happens when you're working with someone in that creative space where stuff shows up and you don't know where it came from. I would love to know, when that happens, is my brain hooking up with him in the ether here and this stuff is showing up? That's something I'd like to know. So if you've ever watched improvisational actors, you know that they can take any topic and instantly create a story or a play. It'll have a beginning, a middle, and an end. It'll have a storyline that flows. It'll contain humor, tempo, and it will all be made up in the action. The performers have no time to think about what they're going to say or do. They can only be in a kind of a dance with the other performers and with what's occurring. They're tuned into each other in such a way that one action spontaneously follows another without the benefit of knowing or understanding where they're going to go. If you ask the actors to explain how they do it, they probably couldn't answer, except to say, you have to do it to get it. In other words, the experience of creating something happens in the act of actually creating it. Another example. In the sports world, we've all seen demonstration of this on the field and on the court, when something shifts for the losing team. And we watch in wonder as they turn a loss into a win. Like the improvisational actors, the athletes transport themselves into a place, and in sports it's called the zone. A place that's located outside of their individuality where nothing exists except the team, the game, and the action. There's actually a biochemist by the name of Barry Sears who he wrote a diet book called Enter the Zone. And it was his assertion that you can eat yourself into this place. I read the book. I did the program. I felt something, but I don't think it was the zone. Okay, so there's one last access point to the experience of creative risk. And I'll briefly mention. And that's commitment. Specifically, through the commitments you take on in your life. The amount of creative risk available is directly proportional to the size of your commitments. If you make big commitments, you'll experience lots of creative risk. If you make small commitments, you'll experience less creative risk. Now, does anyone know why I'm showing this image?
Absolutely.
Anybody?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely, yes.
I love it. Okay, it shows how the difference between being involved, it shows the difference between being involved and being committed. The chicken was involved, the pig was committed. Okay, back to Indiana Jones. So everybody knows he's the greatest archaeologist in the history of the world. He's the foremost authority, an author, a brilliant professor. You could say the driving force in his life is his commitment to archaeology. And you could say that commitment lives in the background for him and shapes and informs his actions in the foreground. So, when Indiana Jones stands in his commitment, 1,000 feet up in the air, he has no alternative but to take the leap of faith. Thank you.
Is the place that is most fertile for collaborative work. As an independent designer working in industry, when I started to experience this real time, it became clear to me that this is the area that's most fertile, but I'd argue that the area that ends up being most satisfying for all parties is around the edge of that dark shape. When you start to push your client out of their comfort zone around commercial opportunity, known technology, brand position, you start to push them in a direction that gets them into new opportunity. And the same for a designer. A designer starts to be pushed into areas that are more about society's concerns or its clients' concerns, then obviously you learn and grow as a designer. So I think it's a pretty concise illustration, but I think what's missing is this notion of that dark zone in the center, that's the easy place to be creative and to bring innovation. But it's not necessarily the place where most innovation happens. And I'm going to just talk briefly about a project I've been working on for the last couple of years that I think is a good illustration of that notion of where things can get uncomfortable, but result in something a little more interesting at the end of the day. A little over two years ago, one of my clients, Herman Miller, one of the bigger office furniture companies in the world, asked me to put together a research program to go out and study what is happening at the very forward edge of workplace strategy. So how companies are using their workplace to affect really positive change in their businesses. I traveled throughout a large part of the world and brought back a research report that I titled Prospect, New Ways of Working. And this is the kind of cover of the report. Again, obviously can't share the whole report with you, but I'll share some of my insights from that report. What I heard universally in Australia and Western Europe and parts of the United States where companies are really considering workplace as a way to encourage positive behavior and discourage undesirable behavior was that companies really struggle to get people to come together and collaborate creatively. Collaboration is knowledge sharing is fairly easy. Get people in a conference room around a table and get them to exchange information, that's fairly easy. But much in line with what Julian said, to get people to work together in a way that increases the creativity and the output exponentially, where they're really the benefit of their own talents and their own outlooks comes together to create something greater than they would do individually, that's a little more challenging. So I started to think about, is there a way to actually use furniture to change people's behavior? Not just to get them to sit in a healthy posture or to look at a computer screen in a way that doesn't cause long-term damage to their body and their health. But is there a way to really change behavior? So I'm working on a program. So I made a proposal to Herman Miller. And I think it was so far out in left field, coming from a direction that they hadn't really considered as their area of interest. If I go back to that diagram from Ames, that area of interest where they think a designer and society and a company come together to create opportunity, that they didn't really know how to interpret it. It was a big creative risk. I pitched a portfolio of product that would really, that was intended to enhance the creative experience in open plan workplaces. And it wasn't so much about a specific archetype of furniture as about an experiment with putting people in the right proximal relationships, postural positions, and giving them the tools to be courageous enough to be creative. And I think if we talk about creative risk, that's really the issue around creative risk. It's most challenging for people, is can I be courageous enough to throw an idea out there that may sound outlandish, outrageous, or ridiculous, and be taken seriously, be appreciated for what I'm risking, and have that land in a way that doesn't make me feel ridiculed, embarrassed, etc. For anybody in here that's part of this school, you know what I'm talking about. You walk into the room and put your work up on the board, and there's a moment of fear every time you do it that if you're really pushing, if you're really stretching creatively, where you've got to stand proud and wear it to take that leap of faith. So this idea was one that Herman Miller really had a struggle with. We see workplaces going completely open plan. Our clients don't want to pay for furniture anymore. They think all the money spent on technology. And this is where my creative risk came in. So instead of saying, okay, I hear you, I'm going to go back and rethink this, and I said, no, I think you're wrong. I think your customers will pay, and they'll pay for the right combination of product and information. For settings that are completely different than you're delivering today, we call this a creative code. And the idea behind this particular setting is you put people in a relationship where they can't disengage, they can't pull their smartphone out and start screwing off in the meeting. They have to interact with the people that are in this setting with them. There's whiteboardable surface around you so you can scribble or post for display ideas and information. And it is intended to support a creative collaboration. Questions? And there are lots of different iterations of this system that you can build with the parts. For all of us who trade in ideas and have to come up with ideas that move our clients and our own work forward, I argue that all creativity is inherently risky. It's not risky, it's not creative. The notion of creative risk is kind of the very foundation of what we do as designers. Does anybody in this room surf? When people talk to me about learning to surf, I've been surfing since I was young. I think surfing is an incredibly hard thing to teach. It requires an amazing amount of patience and persistence. It requires a kind of intuitive sense of position in relation to not only the ocean, but the other people that are out there around you. But most of all, it requires an incredible amount of commitment. Once you decide you're going to catch a wave and ride that wave, you have to be absolutely committed. And sometimes you will get that wave and sometimes you won't. It's a great analogy for the creative process. And the risk inherent in what we do is inherent in all those things in the work. That's my last image. Yes. Thank you.
Bruce, so I graduated here in 1992 from illustration, and I'm just going to read something I just pulled up really quick on the web. This is a little handout I was given out by one of my teachers in Art Center, and this kind of had an effect to me in how I was starting off and learning. And it was just called, I don't see the title anymore. Okay, I think it's hip versus cool. Hip is transitory, smart endures. Hip is defined by others, smart is defined by intelligence. Hip is only for the moment, smart is timeless. Hip is driven by trends, smart is driven by performance. Hip is perpetually looking over your shoulder, smart is making your own decisions. Hip is mango chestnut gelato. Smart is chocolate. Hip is often difficult to define, smart is always logical and defensible. Hip is flash, smart is substance. Hip is something that looks cool, smart is something that works. Hip talks the talk, smart walks the walk. Hip gets you a $300 a week cooking habit, smart gets you a big raise in the corner office. Now this was written a long time ago when you could get cocaine for $300. But that was written in the 80s, I believe, by Hadfern. But you know, I'm the son of an engineer, I have Asperger's, I like logical things, and it's just like, wow, that's something I could hang my hat on. It's like thinking about what's smart, what works. You know, I was always the guy that looked at bridges not for how beautiful they were, but what's underneath them holding them up. I was always fascinated by process, by platforms, by situations. So, my slides are already backwards, but let me see if I can skip to that. So I started off by letting go of my career. I graduated as an illustrator, and I thought I had everything figured out. I was gonna move to New York, I was gonna do editorial work. I went there for a month, I got no work whatsoever. The phone didn't ring, but then, what do you do in a town of 8,000 people that's way off there? Well, I said, let's go, you have some books you wrote, people know who you are, let's just put a classroom out there. Well, people came, and we had people as far as Vienna, Austria, coming out. We had every class we had international, we only had maybe two or three people from California. We had people coming from all over the place, all over the country, all over the world. And it was some of the world's first web design classes that were actually taught in this room that she taught when she is researching the first book on web design. So a lot of the process was we wanted to do other things, and our publisher said no. No, you can't do a book, you can't do this, you can't do that. So we're thinking, what can we do? Well, let's do our own books, let's do our own videos. So we did things because we could, because we had no place for it, we had no place to teach like Art Center in Ohio, so we made everything up that we needed. We were in the process of just trying to figure out how to make things work. We weren't thinking we were making this large corporation. We thought we were making the small little place where Linda can teach a few classes. So Linda.com was born, and what else happened? So everything I was doing was, I was letting go of my career as an illustrator. letting go of my career as an illustrator. And to start Linda.com, I had to let go of everything I knew. So when I thought I was an illustrator, I was doing editorials. The plan was my best friend was going to be the postman and the Federal Express guy, because that's all, I'm an introvert, that's all I need to see. I can be on the phone with the art directors and send the off. And I had to let go of that kind of idea and that career and transform into a business. And that's where we went with Linda.com. And everything was outside of my comfort zones. So now it's a matter, things are going well. Not great, but they're going well. Much better than my illustration career. Things are taking off and growing. And everything were about business decisions and building business models. And a lot of them came out of encountering problems. Problems, issues, licensing, lawyers, everything that I had no idea what the heck I was dealing with. You know, my business classes at Art Center were primarily about how do I invoice a single client? How do I sweep the floor when I'm waiting for jobs to come in? How do I, you know, it's just, my mind was just set, I was gonna be an illustrator. I just had this romanticized view, and now I'm totally out there, and now we're thinking, how do we make this online learning? We want the VHS tapes, the DVDs, and eventually move to an online model. And that became what we call an online training library at Linda.com. And that was a losing model. When we introduced our online aspects, we sold DVDs and VHS cassettes at $150 for a class. When you put them all online for $25 a month, people stopped buying those. So we went from making several million a year off of selling these things to making $50,000. And the business looked bad. It looked really bad. My wife wanted to sell the online training library. She thought it wasn't doing well at all. She set it up, I was gonna meet people, we're gonna sell it off. We could focus on books and the conferences and other things we did. And I looked back and I looked at it, and I noticed it had a very consistent rate of growth. Kind of like a half-life, but in reverse. So it was doubling every year. When we first launched it, we had 35 subscribers in the first month. At $25, it's not enough to pay us for the level of business we were doing. But I noticed after a while it was growing and growing, and in the end, we had over 5 million subscribers paying $25 a month. That's significant. But the model was losing. It cost us dearly. It took 4 years for it to get back to where it was before the end. And to me, it was one of those decisions to really fight for this business, to say, look, this has potential. And look at the numbers and say, this business can grow and this business can scale. She said, okay, but I really don't think so. And in the end, it ended up being bigger than everything we've ever done. So a lot of the business for me has also been about refocusing. So we went from doing classes to other things and really trying to understand what was important and refocusing on what was important and refocusing on what's efficient and refocusing on what is creativity, what is learning. And we made a lot of decisions. We didn't want to be just an online college. We thought of what we could best be as who we are online. And we thought we're not good at testing. And I don't know if the internet's great for testing, it might be all right. We're not good at predatory units. We're not a school, but we like to work with schools. And this is the hard part is, you know, they didn't want Maryland to involve with it. They had their own idea of where it needed to go. And I didn't have a plan B. I'm still playing around with what's plan B, what's next. And I have the liberty and have time now, but it's rather interesting. Part of the process of growing as a large company and the things I never saw to expect were, as I grew, when you add up the 50 employees, it was a flat organization. You knew everybody, invited everybody to your house. After you got the 50, there had to be a structure. And you couldn't invite everybody to your house because your house wasn't big enough. And even at 50 was hard. But then there's a point after about 150, you stop knowing the names of all your employees. I remember meeting somebody at lunch because we had a cafeteria and we fed all of our employees. And I remember introducing myself to this employee and I said, you start this week? He goes, no, I've been here for 2 years. So I just didn't know everybody after, I think I had 100 memory slots for names in my head. To learn a new one, I have to kick somebody out. but to me, it was just like, it was about, I was doing all the illustrations to all the covers. But we were doing so many, I couldn't. In the end, we were doing 230 courses a month. And I did about 3 or 4 covers to the artwork a week, so I couldn't keep up. I had to hire other people. I used to do up to 40% of all the training myself. I had to give that up. Linda had to give that up. And we brought in other people. And a lot of it was about growing. It was really difficult for me because if you're a designer or illustrator, you're a control freak. And you want to do it yourself. And part of the aspect of growing is you actually have to give things away. And it is freaking scary to say, I do this and I do this well, but I'm giving it away. I'm not going to do this anymore. And it's really hard to move on. It's really comforting to do the same thing over and over and over again. And all of this was an experience I never expected to have. And I really think, for me, it's learning about how to embrace curiosity and what is next, where to go from here. And I'm experiencing it all over again. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. When faced with the topic of creative risk, I felt compelled to basically share my career story, which has been a bunch of anecdotal creative risk sort of steps. So I just wanted to maybe share that transparent story with you with the hope that it could give the audience some nuggets of insight. And you use the insights that you collect to have your own sort of creative risk-taking experiences, hopefully. And so, starting from my youth, I had a volition to draw, to sort of exercise creativity, whatever that meant to me as a young kid. But I didn't necessarily know about design until much later in my career. But the way the world's moving, I'm very thankful for the timing in terms of this confluence of all these disciplines coming together. And so, with curiosities around the sciences and art and creativity and innovation, those are some of the early sort of thoughts that were in my head. I chose perhaps the conventional route and entered the workforce as a mechanical engineer in the nuclear power space. And so it definitely satisfied some of those longings for, you know, understanding what innovation was, what technology was, innovation, these kind of things. And I'm super thankful for that experience. I worked 5 years in that industry, crawled in and out of 14 nuclear power plant buildings across the US and South Korea, and it definitely taught me what it meant to create a product, to deliver hardware, a service over the line, and one that definitely had to meet the needs of multiple stakeholders that revolve around these nuclear plants and make hopefully the public safer in many regards. But through that sort of engineering trajectory, I was still drawing for hobby, and there was this burning itch in the back of my mind of, is this really the right path for me? And, you know, again, I went with it and gave this industry 5 years of my career. other curiosities also immersed in that experience, curiosities for business, and a wonderment of why is the clients that we were serving in this regard, why were they making certain choices about us, about other contracts, how were contracts even shaped to begin with? How do you scope, you know, something commercial like this? Those were natural questions, and I lacked the business acumen to be able to have those conversations. And there, I guess you could say there was a growing curiosity to bring on that acumen so that I could be a more empowered technology professional. And so the company that I worked for in this regard was Westinghouse Nuclear out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And thankfully, right down the road was Carnegie Mellon, you know, a business school, just a haven for innovation, multidisciplinary departments. And so there were tons of Carnegie Mellon alumni at the company that I worked, and it was easy to get to know the school through them. And sure enough, after 5 years, I decided to quit my job and go to business school to bring on that acumen. And when you're going through the business school environment, you're faced with many different voices about what you should do for your career. You should go into iBanking. You should go into management consulting. You should start your own business. Don't you want to get rich? Don't you want power and influence? All these voices. And it was actually a tough time for me because I was still that quiet, introverted, you know, curious young man, liked engineering, but definitely was trying to understand this language of business and where that could take me moving forward. All the while, through the business education, I was still drawing for hobby and actually taking little bets, experiments outside of the professional sort of circumstances and doing things like murals for community fashion shows or hanging artwork in local like coffee places and lounges, just to sort of try some creative volition. Again, not knowing what I would do with it, but I just felt this burning desire. Well, when it came time to navigate these environments, and this is a massive MBA career fair, one that most MBA students go to try to court companies, I told myself, you know what, there's something around this desire that I need to listen to. And it actually helped me narrow the choices of companies that I chose to engage and have conversations with. And thankfully, at one of these massive MBA career fairs with thousands of students, hundreds of companies, I happened across Nike Inc.'s booth. And to me, before I even approached the booth, what resonated about Nike was the strong desire for inspiration, innovation, the art of storytelling, technology, strategy, and creative all existed in that environment. And it mirrored the curiosities that were laying dormant within. And when I approached the booth, the guy was pretty stern. He was like, why Nike? Just very like cut to the chase. You know, I better have a good answer. That was his body language. And I just spoke from the heart and told him where my convictions were and that there could be mutual benefit if we, you know, aligned forces. So thankfully, he gave me his card. And as I was navigating business school, I checked in with this person, and Nike ultimately offered me a job. And so I came into Nike in a business capacity, as a business planner, corporate finance, whatever you want to call it. And that was great to learn the language of business in a publicly traded company with the rigor that Nike requires with Wall Street. But the product person in me was still sort of speaking out. But thankfully, I'm in an environment that has all of these disciplines around the Nike campus in Beaverton, Oregon. And so I started having networking conversations, coffee chats. And those coffee chats led to epiphanies, opportunities to make small bets. And so, you know, some people actually questioned why I was like talking to some of the product people, the designers over in the Innovation Kitchen and Nike Product Engine. And I was actually discouraged by that sentiment. I was like, oh wow, am I creating a bad perception walking over to that side of campus? And I was actually sort of disappointed by that. But I kept having conversations. Something said, you still need to keep sort of going and exploring this. And one of the people that I met basically said, Kevin, you're not responsible to anyone for your lunch or your evenings or your weekends. Why don't you come hang out with us while everybody's running around campus to get their workout in? You know, give your creative muscles a try with us. And so thankfully, through a number of stretch assignments, working for free in many regards, after 2 years in corporate planning, I moved into the global footwear product engine of Nike. And so the job that they took a bet on me with was to help the creative teams figure out a better way to manage their ideation to sample confirmation process. And so having my sort of engineering chops as well as the business acumen, we devised digital initiative strategies to enable the creative community to articulate their design intent with offshore partners more clearly, to leverage digital and the active physical product making to amplify the process, to allow them to get through delivering on what they want so that they can spend more time finessing the soul of the product. And so through that process generated a lot of value for Nike. Well, I've met a lot of newfound creative mentors and friends in the act of doing that work in my day job, and that opened up opportunities to take more bets. So some of the creative friends I had saw the personal work I was doing for hobby and encouraged me to actually try not to build shirts. Brand Jordan was the first Nike category that took a bet on me. They said, you know what, we have briefs without a home. Too many briefs, too little designers. They're yours if you're willing to work for it. And so I met, at the time, the footwear design director of Brand Jordan at 6 in the morning, every morning for a year. We would meet together, we would work through whatever we needed to problem solve on the shoe briefs. And then I would go do my day job. And then at night, I would go home and basically work from 7 p.m. to 3 or 4 in the morning, and report back at 6 in the morning with fresh, fresh iterations. And we worked together for a year and made two footwear models together, this being one of the two. And thankfully, the Jordan world, the sneakers flew off the shelves, thankfully, that year, and it opened more opportunities to take more bets in the Nike environment. And I guess you could say that was a soul-searching process to figure out, there's something here, but I really need to think about these small bets that I'm making and see, where is this really going? And at the time, a few shoe projects didn't answer the question for Nike that, oh yeah, Kevin can now be a fully fledged designer, innovator, the world is yours. No, there was tons of skeptics, tons of people that saw my title and said, you know what, you're not good for creativity, you can't do this. And I said, well, through these experiments and the traction that my initial products are getting in the market, there's something here, I want to make the bet for myself. I want to make the bet and get the proper creative foundation in conjunction with the business and technology experiences I've had in tow and really commit to the career path that I want. And that came through an Art Center education. And so thankfully, had the benefit and privilege of studying here for 2 years under Andy's and many others, Tutelage. Was able to cut my teeth and really build that foundation while leveraging the other muscles. And as I was leaving Art Center, I met some like-minded players that believed in the multidisciplinary mission just as much as I did after having made those bets. They made similar bets in their path. And we started doing work together once we sort of discovered each other. And that work was very multidisciplinary. It was very venture-focused. It was very centered on innovation and incubation. And we started doing that work, and it provoked the interest of some very large players in the management consulting and private equity worlds. And a few freelance projects leading to a formal job after Art Center was sort of done, and a few parent companies later, we are working on version 3.0 of ourselves as an innovation and venture incubator inside of Boston Consulting Group. So we basically create startups for the world's most important companies that BCG already serves, as well as leads that we have from our own sort of Rolodexes. And we're design, we're strategy, we're technology, we ring fence, we invite the corporate partners, people into our startup teams as well. And we just walk a creator's process, and we start building against what we discover. And so we're 2 years in, there's 10 of us that started as I was leaving Art Center, and we're now 350 globally. And I would say it was a series of serendipitous bets, creative risks, that led to big sort of forks in the road that required deep-seated commitments to realize those dreams and open new paths for not just me, but many others that had a similar mindset to converge on this opportunity. That's it.
Thanks, great stories. I have one question I want to throw to the group, and then I want to open it up to the room. We're almost 7:30. We said we were going to finish then, so I won't go too long. But on your talk, you were talking about taking creative bets. And some of you may have read some books on creativity, maybe the one that Mr. Csikszentmihalyi wrote. And very interesting in his research, did very extensive research on what he calls big C creative people, people who really change the game in their field. And all kinds of analysis in the characteristics of those individuals. One of the things that he points to, and I wonder if the group can speak to it, you're talking about placing bets. And my hunch is that people who are creative, they're always doing that. What Csikszentmihalyi observed is that was one of the characteristics about highly creative people is they always had multiple projects going. And it was the serendipity of things that started to cross between those things that gave the opportunity. And it's kind of a physical model of what our author that we started this conversation with says is going on in our head, right? So you've got these different ideas that you've collected over a long period of time. They're there as a library. We've got patterns that we use to sort of organize the way we view the world. And then in these moments where they're the right forces, the now where we have to take the risk, that's the library that gives us the adjacencies that can connect. So do you guys keep multiple projects going? That's the question.
Yes, I have multiple projects going, but you know, there's aspects of doing things that are interesting to me, and you know, I've got a lot of failures under my belt, and I think that's a primary aspect of success. And if you're just taking the success from others, you'll never really get there. But I think there's something to do with proximity and problem solving and you know, really getting down to the people you're trying to work with or the problems you're trying to solve, and really being close in proximity that is really helpful. And I think by immersing yourself in these issues and problems, that's where you start to connect the dots. But the dots are really, they're in you. And they're, in my mind, it's more about your life and how you lived and then how you see things through it and then how you see it work. And I think it's part of the reason that we all come up with different answers.
To go around the group, Richard.
I have found in my own experience that creativity comes more through assimilation than some blinding flash of inspiration. It always is a result of making connections. And those connections sometimes result in sort of a flash of inspiration. But you know, I work, my business is always inherently about working across different industries and with different companies. And so I've always got multiple things going on at one time. And it's quite common to make connections between something we're working on in kitchen appliance or lighting or office furniture and having the research, whether it's around user-based research or materials research, trigger something on another area of activity. So yeah, I think it's right that in my experience of people I know who are really creative don't go sit in a dark room and wait for insight. Yeah. They're inquisitive and curious and are engaged in the world, and that engagement creates an opportunity to assimilate and combine.
Right. I think there's a lot of dialogue between students and just general population at Art Center about the amazing workload and staying up all night. And that's actually the byproduct, I think, of the thing that's really getting used to doing multiple things at the same time and kind of managing them all. It starts to build a lifestyle of doing that if it wasn't already your lifestyle. How about you keep multiple projects going? Oh, that's kind of that on your own even, right?
Yes, indeed. Still do. And I think I learned from other trial and tribulation and learning the hard way that you learn to stop listening to no and letting others sort of predefine what it is you're supposed to do and start listening to yourself more and more. And for me, it was, I need to generate enough evidence to feel confident and credible on the things that I wanted to do, let alone others that I would collaborate with. And so the accumulated experience which proved very important for the decisions I make moving forward.
Julie?
I too, my plate's full also. So this thing about commitment, it's really, really, really powerful. And I said there at the end about Indiana Jones that commitment that he had in the background, so Jake, you could call it his calling, shaped and formed the actions that he took in the foreground. And so if you have a calling, if there's something, like Kevin was talking about this thing about creative, it's like he couldn't shake it. That if that's in the background and that's there, there's a commitment in that. And clarifying that, getting who you are out of that commitment can transform your life, literally. So I just started a new startup, right? And people my age aren't supposed to do that. But where it came from is this commitment I have in the background, which is to give people opportunities to unleash their creative self. That's what I live inside of. And that is what enables me and empowers me to start new businesses, to have my plate full, to take on things I shouldn't take on. And it's a very fulfilling life. I mean, it's like I get up every morning and I love my life. So if I can say anything about that, it's about learn what you're committed to, and it's there. Just look, and then grab onto it, and then let it take you.
Thank you. And any questions from our audience? Soren?
Thank you, everybody. This was just very inspiring, so thank you for sharing your experience. So I did an interview series in 3 interviews with Chris Bangle this spring on creativity, managing creative people, and the routines and thumb rules, rules of thumbs for creative and strategy and so forth. And one of the things he talked about was, luck being a big part of it. So defining luck as when preparation meets opportunity, right? And it's kind of pretty obvious from the presentation today. My question is, can we take that one a step further and make it systematic, repeatable, predictable?
Systematic luck.
Yeah. We're talking about little C lucks, but we're talking about big C luck, right? Yeah.
I say no. Creativity is inherently messy, and it doesn't rely so much on process and systemization as on that uniquely human ability to find connection where there is seemingly none, and that unique aspect of personality we call talent, which is to dig deeper and find not only connection where there may not apparently be one, but a beautiful expression of that connection. So I don't know, I've been struggling with this my whole career, this idea of can you find a way to systematize creative process in a studio or among a team. I think it's just inherently messy. It's beautifully messy.
I think that's the system. I think for me, it's funny, we recently took our design team away for an offsite last November, just to sort of get the team away from the realities of growing so fast in this model. And we try to address like systematic concerns, and we had to sort of throw that out and really focus on this theme called grit, like creative grit. And because through the bets, you will sort of hear, even in your own sort of mind, the word no, or this is a failure, then you should stop, give up. and especially in this environment where we are sort of at the sea level with BCG sort of clients and everything, it can get sort of tiring, all the energy that needs to be there to give design a voice. And so I think through the bets, you will sort of hear 99 no's, but if you're persistent, you will hear that one yes that will open a new door and a new path and a new series of opportunities. And so grit is probably the best answer I can get.
I would probably say if you want something systematic, the one systematic thing I think I have going through my process is understanding your true north of where you're going. Everything else is messy. Everything has been failures and stumblings, and you don't end up where you want to go. You kind of go the general direction. I once heard this joke, if you ever want to make God laugh, just tell him you have a plan. seriously, it just, I couldn't have gone further from where I thought I was going. And I just think having a very strong sense of curiosity where you're going and humoring it, and but always keeping your true north of who you are in mind, is probably the best thing I could tell you.
Julian?
Well, systems, for me, produce incremental improvement. And that's what that equates to is taking a look at what you've done in the past and either doing a different version of it, a better version of it, or some other version of it. And that's a formula. And most businesses do that. But over time, all you can expect is, you know, incremental improvement. So there's not a lot of creativity in that. It's safe. But that's, you'll never get a breakthrough in there. It's because it's a formula for incremental improvement. So I would say you can't systematize that.
Actually, the more I think about it, you know, the larger companies get, and my company included, when we got up to 780 employees and we had like 1,400 things, there's so many systems, there's so many processes that innovation and creativity are squeezed out of these companies. And the problem with getting big is they don't want to do too many things new. There's a comfort level in running a large company in that they know how to make money and there's a process to it. And things that you want to do that may be innovative are disruptive to those ways. And you have to be very creative to figure out how to disrupt those ways in ways that are safe and protected that you can bring out when they're developed. And sometimes you have to operate as a rebel group or something, but creativity gets more and more difficult. It's really easy when you're small or it's your company, but even when it was my company and it got big, things got political, things got difficult. You know, you had salespeople with quotas, you had people with their objectives. Systems are difficult to break. Being disruptive is hard.
Having said that, I just have one thought. I think for us, for people who have embraced creativity as kind of our core passion, activity, endeavor, we've developed some muscles and notions or abilities to dare to take risk, to be courageous enough to explore ideas that are uncomfortable first and maybe even put them out. So I think in a larger sense, I hope, and it's part of this initiative I'm working on, that it is possible to actually find a way to apply some good practices and some more research-based methodology around helping people be more creative, dare to be more creative, and develop those muscles that we spend so many years developing. Right? So I think there's something to the idea of wrapping some methodology around the creative process that gets people more comfortable with the risk inherent.
I'm glad to hear it because that's what we